Welcome to Qt's broken model view infrastructure and more. What exactly did you mean, Jesper, when you said when broken indexes were given to the models? Well, imagine a model with 20 rows. And imagine that the view is asking for data for row 21. What? Off by one error? Will the views make such mistakes? Well, don't worry. Not the Q list view, the Q table view, and the Q tree view, but in between the view at the top and your model at the bottom, there might be broken proxy models. And better prevent weird errors because out of bound requests in situations like this. Let me show you what exactly I mean. So what we're looking at here is our good old Depeche model, which now has the ability of actually playing the songs. Are you ready? So music for the masses. What? Violator. What? Okay. Spirit. Playing an angel. Speak and spell. 1980s. Something is terribly wrong here. Let's have a look at what our implementation looked like. We'll start out looking at main.cpp. So I'm creating my Depeche Mode model. What Depeche model? I am creating something called filter collection that is given the model, and I set up my view with this filter. So my view is now listening to the filter collection, which is a proxy model. The filter collection is very, very simple. As you can see, it's a Qsort filter proxy model subclass, and all it does is that it checks whether the model, or it says here, I should include the row if the index of that row data method for is title row is not, that's the not up there, true. So basically throw away all the title rows. You might remember from previous episodes that we had title row saying 1980s, 1990s, and you can actually see the 1980s down here. Hint. And let's go back and look at main.cpp to see what it does. So I've set up my stack here of a view at the top, a proxy model in the middle, and a model at the bottom. And now I have my connection here. My connection says whenever the view is clicked, it will obviously emit a signal called clicked. Then that signal that goes out takes a model index, and I take that model index, I go and ask my model for what is the zeros row. So I could click any column, but I want the zeros column, namely the title column. Give me that that data, or give me an index for that, and give me the data for that index, and convert that to a string, and that is what I expect to be on that position. Had you ever been to one of my Qt Widgets trainings and seen the model view section, you would by now think, oh my God, Jesper, you are never ever allowed to give a index to a model that is from somebody else's model. See, at the top here, my view got an index, namely the index from the model that was clicked, which was the proxy model. And I took that index and I gave it to the widget below. Let me put in a debug line in my data method so you can see that it is actually the wrong class that the index come from. So over in my model, in the data method, remember if we look at main.cpp, it went to the model and asked for the data of this particular index. Let's check what that index is and watch me type really fast. There we are. So what I'm printing out here is who am I? So which model is this? And then which model did the index come from? And when I run the application now, you can see that it prints out Depeche Mode or Depeche Model a bunch of times here, which is when it's asking for the data to populate. But when I move up here to my user interface and I click somewhere, you can see, and I won't move my mouse now because as soon as I move my mouse, it'll ask again, but just above the notes, the tunes or whatever you call those, you can see down there that it says Depeche model and it says Qsort filter proxy model. So what is the cure for this problem? Well, the cure is simple. I need to make sure that the index I give to the model actually is from the model. So I need to go to the proxy model and ask map to source for that index to get it down there. or I need the same trick as we saw in my filter, where I, instead of actually going all the way down to the proxy model at the, or to the model at the bottom, that I ask the model at the top to give me data for a role. So that could be like, give me the album role, and then it would trickle through the model views throughout to get to that. There is a few episodes on that particular trick. Let me link to those in the description below. What is interesting in this episode, however, is what can I do when I write my model initially to prevent a proxy model coming on top of me and calling wrongly into me? Is there anything I can do to actually check these things? And this, yes, there is. Let me show you. So what I could do to prevent disasters from happening, or at least warn about them when they're about to happen, is that in my data method, I could write stuff like, if index.model is different from this, then complain, crash, whatever, do a qassert is a good solution to that. Or if index.row is less than zero, it doesn't make any sense to ask for row minus three. Or if index.row is greater than or equal to row count, are you asking for a row beyond what I have? Or, and that is exactly the kind of code that I and millions, I'm sure, of users out there have written throughout the years. But in Qt 5.11, Giuseppe D'Angelo, a good friend of and coworker of mine, he actually put in a new feature that's called check index. And check index does exactly that. And in the description below, there is a link to a blog post that he wrote a few years ago, telling more details about that. But let's just have a look at what does check index actually do. So check index is given an index, so index here. It's given an additional option where I can do stuff, and then it's you will call qassert on it. So wait, you'll call qassert on it? Why doesn't check index do that by itself? Well, you might have a different way of actually coping with these errors. So qassert, remember, is compiled out in release build. So you might actually in release build still want to check the index and then write into a log file or something like that. That's up to you. So qassert and then call the check index. But let's see what does check index actually look like. So let's start out looking at the documentation for check index. We can see that it takes the index to check and it takes a check index options, which has four enum values. No option index is valid. Checking that the index is actually valid, the one given, doesn't make any sense to ask for data for the invalid index. Parent is valid. Sometimes that is a requirement. Do not use parent. So in the implementation of parent, it doesn't really work out if you ask for the parent itself, because then you're just ending up in a recursion. Let's also see the implementation for check index. It's actually rather simple. So it goes like this. Correction, it's rather simple to understand. It would be very hard to write if you were to add code like this in all of your methods. So first of all, if the index is not valid, then if I expected it to be valid, then complain. And I complain using categorized locking. There's an episode on that. Look for the episode on debugging techniques. And I return false. If the model is different from myself, then unconditionally complain. That's where this whole episode started. If the row is less than zero, complain. If the column is less than zero, complain. If do not use parent, meaning if okay with looking at the parent, and I'll get the parent here, and if the parent must be valid and it isn't valid, complain. I'm still okay using the parent, so I'll go and ask for the row count for the parent. And if my row is greater than or equal to the row count, complain, and similar for the column count. So that's it. Check index, and you're very welcome. I'll take your thank yous until Giuseppe D'Angelo, also known as Pepe. What do you mean that you can never remember exactly which option to give in what method? And what do you mean that you are bored by that you need to write this Q_assert, it should have been part of the whole infrastructure. Well, QWidgets and more to the rescue. I've written a bunch of macros that will help you in those setup. Let me show them to you. So the macro that I wrote will take this Q underscore search, check index, blah, blah, blah line and replace it with something much simpler. First of all, the Q underscore search is now built into the macro. Second, the macro is named in a way so I don't need to remember exactly which flag. So check underscore data. See, I'm in the data method here, check underscore data. Up here, I'm in the row count, check underscore row count, and so on. Let's look at what does check underscore data do? That's the macro we have here. And yes, I hate macros just as much as the next guy, but macros has one advantage, namely that they will be the code will be inside of your function. If it has been a function, then the qAssert would complain in that function rather than inside of your row count method, for example. So the macro here tests, first of all, if it's a table or a list model. If that is the case, then it'll call check index with the index. The index must be valid and the parent must not be valid. Otherwise, it's okay for the parent to be valid and then it just checks for the index. We have a whole bunch of those. Check row count just calls check index. Check column count just calls check index. And as you can see, there's a bunch more down here. And there's a few of them that actually does much more than the check index. You can see here, check insert row. It checks the parent is okay. So it's the parent is from the right model and so on. And then I check that the row that I want to insert is also okay. So it's the row is below row count of my parent and it's above zero. And that I actually want to insert a positive amount of rows. You can read all the code in here. It took quite a bit of engineering to get it working entirely correct and get those that the row here could, for example, be less than or equal to row count. My first implementation just said less than, but then I cannot append at the end of the list. So needed to be less than. And if you find any bugs in here, by all means, do write a comment in the field below and I'll update the code. That was one of those macros that caused me a lot of grief. So let me just share that with you. If you do something really advanced with ModelView, you are likely to hit that exact case. So it was the implementation of check capital letter underscore index, the method that was called whenever the check index method was called. In there, I check that the row and column are within bounds. It doesn't make any sense to ask for an index for row 5 when you only have 4 rows, or column 5 when you only have 4 columns. But nevertheless, Qt was actually calling a check index for row 0 when I already told it I don't have any rows. And what was up with that? Well, I'll show you. So the problem came because I had a Qt abstract proxy model sitting above my model. Not the most usual thing. You usually just have a Qsort filter box, Qsort filter proxy model, or a Qidentity proxy model, or a subclass of these sitting above you. But I had a proxy model that was actually flipping, I think, or it was throwing away columns or rows or something like that. Now, its header data implementation, I hadn't changed that. So it looked like this. And what you can see here is that if I want to know the header data, I'm a proxy model, so I need to map to the underlying model. What I needed to know was that I want to have the header data, let's see, horizontal. So I wanted to have for column number 3, I wanted to know that. But I needed to know column number 3, what column number is that in my source model? So what it does here in this implementation is that it says, can you give me an index for column number 3, row number 0, map that, and now I'll go and ask for, that's the mapping here. And then I'll go and ask for the header data in my source model, my D pointer model, that's my source model. I'll ask for the header data for this section. So if I throw away columns, if I ask for column number 3 in the source model, it might be column number 5. Works perfectly fine, except that if I don't have any rows in my model, then I'll go and ask, can you give me an index for column number 5, that's a section here, row number 0, but I don't have any rows, so asking for row number 0 is actually wrong. The solution to this problem is to implement the header data myself. I know when I implement a subclass of Q abstract proxy model, I know how I am reordering my columns and my rows, or throwing away, or even inventing them. So in that case, I know how to map without calling this dangerous index of column zero. Very advanced stuff, but if you ever implement a Q abstract proxy model and you use the check underscore macros, you are likely going to be hit by this. If you're not using them, hey, your model might actually just work perfectly okay, because it will just give away for column an index for row zero, even if it doesn't have any rows. But then you don't have the security of giving array row five when you only have four rows, which another broken proxy model above you might be asking for. That's it for this episode of Qt Widgets and More. I'm Jesper Pedersen. I'm from QTopia. And just in case that you're sitting there saying, oh my God, how am I ever gonna get my models working? There's so much I don't know. I really should know them from the bottom up. Don't despair. Instead, send an email to us and we'll gladly help you with, say, a virtual one-day training on ModelView, where we'll go into all the details that you would be able to fetch from this whole Qt Widgets and More series, but in a much more structured way. Again, thank you for watching, and see you next time.